welcome to another Women Lead TV show sponsored by Connected Women of Influence. I'm Michelle Beauchamp, your host for Crossing Bridges, where we dive into challenges that women in business face, understanding the obstacles that they encountered, figuring out what lessons they learned so that they could get from one part to the other, how they crossed the bridge so they could get to where they wanted to go. I'm excited to introduce you to our guest, Ellen Clark. Hey, Ellen.
Hi.
I'm so happy that you're here today.
Me too. Thank you.
Ellen, let's start off by you telling them, what is it that your company is? What's the name of it so they can understand that? And what do you do?
So my company is Control Corrective Skincare Systems. I know it's a mouthful. And we also have a company called Global Beauty Private Label Skincare. And that's another mouthful. But these are, I've been making skincare products for professional estheticians for many years. Prior to that, I was an esthetician. I had my own skincare clinic, and I actually taught a lot of estheticians throughout the U.S. And finally, my dream was to start my own brand, but you know how you have a goal here, but it was a windy road to get there. So prior to starting my own brand, I had already done thousands of facials, and I kind of really knew and honed my expertise. And then when I launched my own brand, it's been 20 years. We're a small brand, and we're trying to grow.
So what I hear you saying is that you walked in the shoes because you did the work. And, you know, I think that's so important because you understand the challenges. We're talking about challenges,
yeah,
how to cross the bridge. You understand the challenges that other people have. And Ellen, 20 years, that's a long time.
Yeah.
So congratulations.
I think what you just brought up, though, is really good that I know my customer because I'm selling to estheticians and I am an esthetician. And I know the challenges in the treatment room, and I know the challenges of a consumer because I grew up with cystic acne and I struggled. And so my whole focus is on corrective skincare, on helping people feel better and look better with products that work and can help them diagnose what products they need, you know, to achieve their goals.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you are helping people become more confident because
that's my goal.
That's your goal. In fact, that was your why, right?
That's my why.
Yeah. So that's awesome. Yeah. 20 years is a long time, Ellen. And so help us understand for the person who's watching us right now and they've been in business and they might be struggling. What would you say, if you had to take a look over the last 20 years, what would you say might have been your biggest obstacle? Can you narrow that down to like your biggest obstacle?
I think there's so many. I would say my biggest obstacle was I didn't understand numbers. I didn't know sales. I didn't know return on investment. I knew nothing about cash flow. I knew none of that. I mean, I knew I was a good esthetician, and I knew that I loved my customers, and I loved educating, and I loved selling product. And I stayed very, very small, so I stayed profitable, but I didn't grow fast because I think probably in hindsight, I just didn't know how you even understand these numbers. Like a bookkeeper would show me my P&L and I would just be like, what? It's like looking at a foreign language.
Okay.
I couldn't grasp it. And then, that was huge. So that was an obstacle to really growing a business. If you don't know your numbers,
you
it's really
your numbers.
Hard.
Yeah. And so how did you overcome that?
So it was a process. It took a long time of constantly just going back, looking at things. And I sought out advisors. I went to networking groups. I asked a lot of questions. I read books. I listened to YouTube things. And I just took a little bit at a time. You know, honestly, up until a few years ago, I couldn't tell you what a balance sheet versus a P&L was. And I've been in business a long time. So now what I've learned is that when you know your numbers, the best thing is you can ask better questions.
Right. Okay.
So it's like a Rubik's cube. Things start to make sense.
Okay.
So
things
in your
start
business,
to come together.
Yeah, like if you're spending, you go, someone says, "Hey, you want to advertise and it's $1,000 a month, however you're going to market it." I used to never think about return on investment and by how long and what does that look like and how much am I spending and how much per customer? Like I didn't do any of the deep dive, but if you take the time to do it, or if you don't know how, like me, and you find your bookkeeper or somebody to help you, it'll make a big difference. So you're not trusting other people that work for you to say, "I need more money. I need more money." And you just keep giving it to them.
Mm-hmm. You know? So I heard you say a few things. One was you didn't have to have all the answers yourself. And I think that as a business owner, it's important for us to realize, I mean, you knew esthetician. You knew that, and you had a passion for it.
Yeah.
And so you were willing to reach out and get the support and help from others. You said you used advisors. And because of your willingness to step out of your comfort zone, recognize that you didn't have to have all the answers, you utilized resources around you. And the other thing I heard you say was it didn't happen overnight.
No.
There were steps.
I think there's way too much emphasis on growing fast.
Okay. Tell us more about that.
Way too much emphasis. I was talking to a young lady who was not all of 19 a few weeks ago.
19.
Who was upset that she started her business in September. She wrote an app. I think I was telling you.
Yeah.
And she doesn't know why that sales aren't coming in. And it's just, I get that. Like when you're young and you're anxious and you're on YouTube and you look at all these influencers and they're making all, mm-hmm. it appears that everyone's happy and
right.
making money
mm-hmm.
and you're missing the boat. You know, it's a much longer journey. And there are people that start businesses and they make a lot of money and then they fizzle out.
Right.
I mean, my greatest strength is that I haven't fizzled out.
20 years, that's why I'm saying. That is something to be commended. That's a long time to be in business.
When women in business, you know, you just take it and you're learning.
Right.
You can't know it all. I beat myself up and that's been a challenge.
Mm.
So, I still do. I mean, I have to watch it. I've actually named my negative talk to poor pitiful Pearl. That was a doll in the post depression, my mother used to say.
Poor pitiful Pearl.
It was a real doll. You can look it up on probably eBay. And I name her. So if I hear that negative talk, like I'm not doing this, I'm not doing that, with, I say, Pearl, stop it.
Oh.
Because it just infects us and it keeps us from, you know, thinking we should know everything that we can't
know.
Oh,
that's awesome. You know, I love that because the self-talk is so important. On my vision board, I have, you know, the little Valentine's Day candies.
Mm-hmm.
I have a little heart, and on it, it says self-talk. So I can remind myself, wait a minute, Michelle, what are you saying to yourself? So I'm really glad you, but what's a poor, pitiful Pearl?
Nobody ever needs to know
that. That's funny. But that's awesome
because
that's how you stop yourself from that negative self-talk.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, we all know, and if you're watching this, what you know is that getting into a woman's support group is critical.
Mm-hmm.
I've been in women's support groups. I've had a business coach. I've had mentors, and everybody along the way has helped keep pulling me forward. And when I feel really bad, I don't isolate. And I think that there's a tendency to do that. So you want to get into a women's support group when you're not feeling depressed,
right?
Or like it's because you just like you need your friends when you need them, not when you have to make friends. So you go join a networking group, and I've been in all kinds of things, and it's helped me, you know, because I'm not alone.
You're not alone, and so thus Connected Women of Influence. I mean, this program is brought to you by Connected Women of Influence, and I just went to a luncheon a couple days ago, and what I found was that you get encouragement from people, and you know, I found that there was another lady there, and we were sharing the same frustrations with understanding social media. I was talking to other people, and I had a meeting after that with another lady who we were brainstorming about some things. So just the whole support system, you're right, it's very important. No matter how long you've been in business, right? I mean, as a person who's just starting and a person who's been in business for a long time.
Yeah, and you know, just before we got started, Michelle and I were talking about networking events, and it's hard to go to them. We know that. Like, people don't show up sometimes. They don't go to classes. You're like, I'm too tired, I'm too busy. That's a mistake, because when I started way back, I would not go to certain things. But when I would go, I'd feel so invigorated.
Energized.
I'd stay connected. So my advice is you find one good group if you're not doing anything right now, and get out there and just make a commitment, because we're in networking groups, you know, it's like anything. It takes time to connect and build the relationship and get the support. And find the right support system.
Right. And I think a key part is consistency on that.
Yeah.
Because what I found over the years is you can't just pop in and out and expect to develop relationships.
Right.
And you definitely can't pop in and out and expect for people to give you leads and give you referrals. It's all about relationships.
Well, it took me years to really understand the relationship piece to selling, too. I
mean,
that's your expertise. But really, people buy from people they like, that they feel they trust.
Absolutely.
That you know, and so if you're trying to sell whatever you're trying to sell and you don't really get that piece of it in a meaningful way, it's going to be harder.
It is.
It's going to take longer.
Absolutely. So speaking of support system, sounds like putting together at least one organization that you knew you could meld with was important. What else do you have in your support system? Because people who are watching, they're probably trying to figure out who can my support, maybe the person's at home, maybe the person's not at home. Help
us
understand that.
So when I started, like if you have a small business, when I had my skincare clinic and I didn't know anybody, I started my own group. Mm. Like you can create your own group. And I was talking to someone not long ago and I suggested they start their own meetup group. So if you join like a Woman of Influence group, that's great. But if you don't have one in your neighborhood, you could always go on Meetup. I think they charge like $35 and start, like this gal was an esthetician. And I said, start a professional aesthetics meetup group in your community. Because what happens is then she can, you know, share. I do eyelashes, you do waxing,
right.
I do facials. Let's see how we can
synergy.
We can buy together. Mm-hmm. We can make, you know, there's just so much, but you may have to be the one that drives it. If you are the one that does, it's going to pay off.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So I want to shift a little bit because as an employer for 20 years,
mm-hmm.
you've had to hire people. And sometimes that's a challenge for businesses. Mm-hmm. Hiring somebody who has the same vision that you do is not easy. And also keeping employees who, you know, they're not so laser focused on, well, that's not my job, but finding people who they're willing to do the, what I like to call the and then some. Tell us a little bit about what kind of challenges you might have experienced, but how you turn that around mm-hmm. to hire people who you felt were really motivated to help you grow your business.
So I've learned a lot, particularly in the last few years.
Really?
And sometimes the people you start with, they're not the people you're going to continue mm-hmm. with. And some people they are. Because the job that you hired them for 4 or 5 years ago is a different job than it used to be. So, mm-hmm. you know, you might have hired somebody because you're really small and there's three of you wearing every hat.
Mm-hmm.
The mistake I made was that in one case, she grew with the company, but she wore every hat. And
okay.
there's no accountability when you wear every hat.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what employees really need is they need to know the job description. It needs to be really well written
mm-hmm.
and expectations. And so if I didn't do that in the beginning, it was kind of like everybody did everything. And
right.
then everybody said, it's not my fault. You know.
Oh,
so
okay.
so
no
now what we do is we're really clear on what the expectations are.
Okay.
And have just a better communication and
okay.
review.
Okay. So now that's important too, review.
Yeah.
So tell us more about that, because I've run into companies and work with companies who nobody wants to do the dirty work. So the employee doesn't get the feedback about the corrective action that's needed, and then the person ends up getting fired, where maybe if they would have been redirected, they could have been saved, and they could help them grow and become a better employee. So
yeah, I mean, in theory, your manager or, you know, if you're the manager or the owner, you need to be communicating often. How's it going? How do you like it? An annual
right.
review is something that some people don't believe in, some people do. I think what I think is good about an annual review is it's time to take a break, go out to lunch with that person and share what you've really appreciated about them, and also talk about the job and talk about what the goals are currently and in the future and how you see how they can contribute to the organization in a more meaningful way, and see if they're, what are their goals, what are their challenges.
What
people want to be listened to.
Absolutely.
So sometimes it's not like you have to necessarily give them more money, but you have to acknowledge what they're doing and celebrate that with them. And I think it's just a pause, you know, time. So but not everybody's the right fit. I mean, that's just it. The companies have culture. Don't feel bad. The biggest mistake most small businesses have is we keep people way too long and then we only have ourselves to blame because
mm-hmm.
we're nice and we care and
mm-hmm.
we want to help them. And
mm-hmm.
next thing you know, we have the wrong person in that job and then we're frustrated. So, you know, I don't know the answer. I think it's just to be very to clear, you know.
Well, you said it. Everybody wants to be listened to. And when people are listened to, they feel important. And when they feel important, then they feel like they're a part of the team. So I think that it pleases me to hear that you do that and keep that up. And I think that other companies or whoever's listening and watching right now are going to be able to understand that.
I think two mistakes I've made as an owner, I haven't communicated my expectations
okay.
as well of what I expect of that person.
Okay.
So they're just trying to please you, but
right.
they don't know if they're pleasing you. And
okay.
they don't know, is this what she really wants from me, you know, or something else. So So just getting clarity on that and having those, just keep talking through it until, you know, you'll know if it's the right person. But I'm much more clear on accountability and setting those things. What is that KPI, the key performance indicator?
Yeah.
What does success look like in this role?
Right.
Yeah.
So this has been such a great discussion, and I know we could go longer, but we're almost out of time. I do want to ask you though, Ellen, we're in a new year, and so what are you most excited about with your business right now? What are you most excited about?
I feel like I have the best team of people I've ever had. I'm really excited. We've just launched a new vitamin C serum. It's very exciting.
Oh, congratulations. That's exciting to know.
First time we've launched it in this way. We have a great, you know, it's just my team really coalesced and came together. So I'm just really excited for the future. I mean, I am in an extremely competitive industry, beauty, but, you know, our customers are what we focus on, and just delivering exceptional product, exceptional customer service, and small businesses are the backbone of this country. So.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. So thank you so much,
thank
Ellen,
for
joining us today.
Yeah, thank you.
And for those of you who are watching, we really thank you for watching another session of Women Lead TV, brought to you by Connected Women of Influence. I'm Michelle Beauchamp, and we'll see you next time.